Okay, we're gonna go ahead and get started. I don't know how many people are actually on yet, but it is recorded. So if people miss something, they can get on or look at it at a later time. All right, well, welcome to ECG Rounds. Oh, this one's in the chat. Hi. So today we will be going over AV blocks, but just another refresher of normal conduction system of the heart. So you have your sinus node up here. Electrical activity goes down through the atria, through the middle part, which is called the AV node. And then it goes down to the lower chambers of the heart. So today we're mainly going to be focusing on the AV node. We're talking about AV blocks.
Nope, don't need anything stepwise. You can just eat as normal. Everything else is normal.
So going through the different blocks, we'll go over each one. So you can break it up into first degree AV block, second degree AV block, and then there are multiple types of second degree AV block. So you have Mobitz type 1, which is also called Winky block, you may hear. There's also Mobitz type 2. And then in some cases, you can't determine whether or not it is type 1 or type 2. And so in those cases, you just describe it as, some people say high or low grade, or you can describe it as in terms of the degree of block. So like a 2-to-1 block means 2 P waves for 1 QRS, or 3-to-1, 4-to-1, et cetera. And then you have your third degree AV block or a complete heart block, as some people call it. So with first degree AV block, what that is just a delay of conduction as the electrical impulse travels through the AV node. And some of the most common causes are high vagal tone. Certain drugs can cause it. So we commonly see it in dogs that are on Sotalol, certain electrolyte disturbances, and then it can occur as just an aging idiopathic degeneration of the electrical system of the heart. And so what you will see on the ECG is there will still be a P for every QRS and a QRS for every P. So you still have all your parts. So remember P, QRS, T. But the PR interval is prolonged. So that is what first degree AV block is, just a prolonged PR interval, which is from here, the beginning of your P wave, to the onset of your QRS complex. And in order to know that the PR interval is prolonged, you have to know what normal is. And so normal PR interval for a dog is 130 milliseconds, and in cats, it's 90 milliseconds. So anything over that is considered a prolonged PR interval or first degree AV block. And this is something that I don't expect most people to be able to pick up on just by glancing at an ECG, especially if it's mild. And you know, a lot of times you may not notice if it's mild unless you're actually measuring the PR interval, which no one routinely has their calipers out measuring, but that is something you can do. So sorry, some of these are blurry. They have really good pictures. I have a book from Dr. Santilli that goes over ECGs. If everyone and anyone ever wants a good ECG book to look at, it's at my desk and it's a really good review. So anyways, I stole a lot of pictures from that book. Because they very nicely highlight the AV blocks. So looking at this ECG, you have a P and then a QRS T, P, QRS T, and you have a P, you can't see the rest, but it goes on for a QRS T. So you have a P for every QRS and a QRS for every P, so all your parts are there, but you'll note that the PR interval, so from the onset of the P wave to the QRS, is quite long. And this one, especially, I mean, even the naked eye can tell this is pretty long. And if you measure the PR interval, it's well over the 130 milliseconds. This is a dog's ECG. So here's another example. Again, you have P, QRST, P, QRST, P, QRST. So you have all your parts. But the PR interval is prolonged. So if you measured it, it's over 130 milliseconds. So that is first degree AV block. Then moving on to second degree AV block. With second degree AV block, you have an intermittent interruption of AV nodal conduction. So essentially on the ECG, you will have some Ps without a QRS, and then it will change depending on the different types. So a type 1 or a Winky block, you have a gradually prolonging PR interval until an impulse is blocked. So your PR interval will get longer and longer and longer until you have a P without a QRS. The causes of type 1 second degree AV block are similar to first degree AV block. So it's typically due to high vagal tone, drugs, that kind of thing. It can also be normal in puppies. So it's important to note that either Mobitz type 1 or type 2 AV block can be normal in growing puppies. I commonly see referrals for that, and that can be normal. And then Mobitz type 2, again, you have some peas without a QRS. But when you have a QRS complex present, the PR interval is consistent. So you're always going to have the same PR interval. There's just some that don't get conducted through. And the causes, typically we think of Mobitz type 2 more related to the causes of third degree. So it tends to be more disease of AV node itself that causes Mobitz type 2, but there is some overlap. So it is still possible to be due to high vagal tone in type 2 cases. And we can see it occur due to some drugs. So it's not a hard and fast rule that type 1 goes with first degree and type 2 goes with third degree, but that is kind of the in most cases. And then again, if you get more advanced second degree AV block, you can say high grade, meaning it's occurring frequently. And or you can describe it as in terms of the number that are getting conducted. So if it's 2 to 1 or higher, you can't classify it as type 1 or type 2. So you basically need at least 2 PR intervals in a row to be able to say whether they're staying consistent or prolonging. And I'll show examples of all of these next. So perfect example of second degree type 1. So you have P, QRS, T, P, QRS, T, P, QRS, T, P, then you don't have a QRS. So this is your second degree AV block. You just have a P with a missing QRS complex. And if you look then, so you know it's second degree, so then you're trying to decide if it's type 1 or type 2. So you look at the PR intervals, that's where you go to. And if you can see here, the PR interval is 105 milliseconds, then it's 118. 120, then it blocks. So the PR interval is getting longer, which is a type 1. And then this is an example of second degree type 2. So again, P, QRS, T, P, QRS, T, P, no QRS. So that's your second degree AV block, and then P, QRS, T resumes. And so second degree AV block, you need to know if it's type 1 or type 2. So you look at the PR intervals. And if you're measuring the PR intervals, they're 80 milliseconds. So every time they're 80 milliseconds. So the PR interval is consistent, which makes it a type 2. And then here is an example of when you can't say whether it's type 1 or type 2. So you have P, QRS, T, P, no QRS. P, QRS, T, P, no QRS. And so you can't say if the PR interval is getting longer because you only have one PR interval before a block. If that makes sense. So this you would describe as a 2 to 1. So you have 2 P wave for 1 QRS, 2 to 1. This dog also has some first degree AV block, which is not uncommon too, that sometimes you'll have first and second degree together. And then here is a 3 to 1 AV block. So you have P, QRS, T, P, no QRS, P, no QRS, P, QRS, T. And so this would be 3 to 1. So you have 3 P waves for 1 QRS. Sorry, I think it's loud. Tell me and I'll tell the people around me to stop talking. Just kidding. So third degree AV block. This is when no atrial impulses can reach the ventricles. And so the heart rate is dependent on the escape rhythm. So we call it an escape rhythm when the normal conduction is not occurring. So you have an abnormal focus that's controlling the heart rate. And on ECG, there'll be no relationship between the P waves and the QRS complexes. And so in cats, the ventricular escape rhythm often remains over about 120 or so. It can be down to 80 and as high as 140, but it's usually around 110, 120. That's because their ventricular escape rhythm, spontaneous rate of depolarization for their ventricles is higher than with dogs. And so a lot of cats, I find their third degree AV block is actually missed because they come in the hospital, they have a heart rate of 120, which we consider normal for dogs, but that's not usually normal for a cat in the hospital. So anytime you have a heart rate of 120 or so in a cat. I always would get an ECG just to make sure that it's not something like AV block, because I've found several that are missed because they just don't do an ECG. And the other important thing with cats is they're often asymptomatic. So it often is an incidental finding that they have this. Because the escape rate is so much higher, they usually don't just develop any symptoms. And then in dogs, the ventricular escape rate is usually lower. So dogs, ventricular escape rhythm is usually a rate, is usually around 40 to 60 beats per minute. But we can see even lower. So definitely if it's very slow, some dogs will be even less than 30. I think the lowest I had once was like 23 beats per minute, and the dog is still a patient of mine. The owner is very, very needy, but he's been doing well with his pacemaker for years. So if the rate is very slow and or the complex is very in morphology, those are really dogs that we're concerned could have sudden death. So with third degree AV block, that's the major concern, is that they are at a high risk for sudden death in dogs, less so in cats. And so with third degree AV block, this is a dog. So you have P, QRS, T, P, P, QRS, T, P, QRST. And so if you look at just briefly, you might think, oh, this P and QRS are related. But if you follow it, there's no consistent relationship between the P and the QRS. So this one doesn't even have a P in front of it. And so they're not related, even though there's QRST complexes and P complexes, they're not related to each other. And if you map it out, you can see kind of the P waves are going at one rate. There's probably one buried in here. And then the ventricular complexes have their own separate marching to their own little beat of their drum. This is another example of third degree AV block. So again, you have your P waves marching along, and then you have your QRS complexes separate. So the QRS complexes are wide and bizarre because they're coming from the ventricles. And then there's no relationship between the P and the QRS complexes. So they're completely separate rhythms. And it's important to know that this is a ventricular escape rhythm. So even though they look wide and bizarre, they're not ventricular premature complexes. They are an escape rhythm. So you don't want to suppress these from happening because they are keeping the dog alive. Okay, and if anyone has any questions at any time, just put it in the chat. But moving on to treatments. So first and foremost, we want to do an atropine response test in most cases. So anytime there is a bradycardia, whether it's an AV block or even a sinus bradycardia or a period of sinus arrest, anytime you have too slow of a heart rate, you want to do an atropine response test. The only exception is in most cases of complete third degree AV block. Typically dogs don't respond. We don't always do it in those cases, but definitely second, first degree or any sinus bradycardias, sinus arrest, we always want to do an atropine response test. And what that means is you're giving atropine. Typically we do the dose 0.04 mg per kg is the dose I recommend giving IV or IM. If you give it IV, they should respond within 5 minutes. If you give it IM, it can take up to 30 minutes to respond. So typically we give it IV if possible, just for time's sake. And so if they respond, which the definition of a complete positive response is complete resolution of the AV block, and an increase in heart rate should be over 140 to 160. So they should become tachycardic. And so if they completely respond to the atropine, they have a positive response, that just means that the AV block or bradycardia or whatever you have is secondary to high vagal tone, because the atropine got rid of all that vagal tone. If they have no response at all, that it's usually indicative of primary AV nodal disease in the case of AV block, or if you had like a sinus arrest, it'd be indicate sinus node disease. So if they don't respond, it means you have disease of your conduction system of your heart, which in most cases in dogs is idiopathic or unknown. We can see third degree AV block occur from other rare things like a mass in the area of the AV node, or Lyme disease has been reported, but most cases are just idiopathic degeneration of the AV node. It is important to note that when you give atropine, they can temporarily, or atropine can temporarily cause AV block initially, especially if you use lower doses. So that's why I don't use the point, and most people I know that are cardiologists don't use the 0.02 mg per kg, because a lot of times they'll tend to have some AV block. And then if they don't respond, you just have to repeat the dose. So just go big or go home. And that's because the atropine actually increases the rate of discharge of the sinus node first, before the AV node. And so this, if the sinus node rate increases, but your AV node hasn't had time to catch up, you're going to have some beads coming from your sinus nodes and P waves that aren't going to be able to be conducted through the AV node yet. So you're going to have temporary AV block. And I think we've had some cases under anesthesia or something like that where someone gets atropine and they see that. And if you're not aware, it can be scary, but that's to some degree expected. And so this is an example of an atropine response test. So you have your P, QRST, P, QRST, P, no QRS, P, QRST, P, QRST, sorry, P, no QRS, P, QRST, P, QRST, P, no QRS. So you have some Ps without a QRS, but you do have some that are conducted. So this is second degree AV block. To know if it's type one or type two, you look at your PR intervals. So here you wouldn't be able to assess that, but there are multiple PR intervals in a row, so you can assess. Sometimes you need your little handy dandy calipers to really tell if it's prolonging, but this one especially, you can tell that it is getting longer. So this PR interval is longer than this one. So this would probably be a second degree type one. And so you give your atropine, and then again, within 5 minutes IV, they should respond. And this would be considered a positive response. So you have no more AV block. So all your Ps are conducting, and it's obviously very tachycardic. So this would be considered a full complete response. So that AV block in the previous slide would be secondary to high vagal tone. So then lastly, moving on to treatment. So first degree AV block does not require any treatment. Again, a lot of times it's secondary to high vagal tone or drugs or whatnot. Does it cause them any clinical problems? So it does not require any treatment at all. Second degree Mobitz type one, again, typically does not require any treatment. You can give atropine to make sure it resolves. If it fully resolves, it's just secondary high vagal tone or other things. So nothing to be concerned about. If you have second degree Mobitz type two, it depends on the grade/severity, whether or not it needs to be treated. So if you have a P wave that's blocked every once in a while, the overall heart rate's normal, they have no clinical signs, that's something that we would probably just do benign monitoring. We'd monitor their ECG regularly, especially if it responds to atropine, then it's not concerning. But if it does not respond, we would probably just monitor for the time being. If they have high grade or pretty frequent AV block, so if they're like that one ECG I showed that had like 4 P waves per one QRS, and so it's resulting in a bradycardia, especially if the animal is symptomatic, then the treatment would be placing a pacemaker. And they can change as well. So especially the higher grade AV blocks, there is concern that eventually it would progress to third degree AV block. So you definitely, if it's high grade, you're having multiple Ps without a QRS, you at least either want to put a pacemaker or at least monitor them very closely because it could progress to complete third degree AV block. And so then lastly, third degree AV block, the treatment is a pacemaker as soon as possible. So in dogs, so when it comes to dogs, third degree AV block, they have a higher risk for sudden death, especially the slower the heart rate gets or the ventricular escape rhythm gets. And so you want to put a pacemaker in as soon as possible. This is one that typically cardiologists will put place a pacemaker on an emergency basis. I have seen dogs that live a couple months with it. If for some reason they can't do a pacemaker right away and they need to save up money, it is possible for them to live with it for a little bit. So if they don't necessarily need to euthanize right away, if they just need to save up money, but there is always a risk of sudden death. So pacemaker as soon as possible. In cats, again, usually they're asymptomatic and their ventricular escape rhythm rate is higher. And so we typically don't treat cats if they're not having any symptoms, and typically just monitor them. If a cat is having symptoms though, especially things like syncopal episodes, then we can put a pacemaker in them. We had a cat who I learned just recently passed away, but had intermittent periods of third degree AV block and was having syncopal episodes when he had the third degree AV block. So that cat did go for a pacemaker. And if you're still confused, I found this heart block poem that is actually quite catchy. So if the R is far from P, then you have first degree. Longer, longer drop, then you have Winky Bop. If some P's don't get through, then you have Mobitz 2. If P's and Q's don't agree, then you have third degree.
Okay, you got me with the poem.
You want to read it again? So if everyone wants to print that, I hope you remember the different degrees or book. Yeah. And then just to plug the next ECG rounds, I'm going to do on January 19th. It's again a Wednesday, it'll still be at noon. I haven't decided what rhythm I'm doing. So if anyone has something they really want to learn about, just email me. But I'll email the reminder when it gets closer. Who is doing pacemakers around us? So UT is who I've been sending them to. That's the closest. I've had a couple go to Georgia, depending on where people live, University of Georgia. Auburn did before, but they didn't have cardiologists. They do have, Dr. Winters is going back there. I believe he's starting after the new year. So I have to contact him to see when he's going to start doing procedure. So we could also send pacemakers to him once he starts. And I would call if like on the ER, if you have a third degree V block or something like that, and they want to go for a pacemaker, I would always encourage you to call first to make sure, especially I know sometimes they're on diversion or oxygen cases, just like we are here. Any other questions? No, perfect. Thank you, guys. Oh, there's another question. Oh, you're welcome. Perfect. That is it. Becky will, it's recording, so she'll post it, or I'll have, I'll let you guys know where she's going to post it. Also, I could send out the, or share the PowerPoint. I know last time there were several people on the PowerPoint, so I'll share the PowerPoint after this so that you guys can have the slides too. Okay, bye.